Hello there. It is Star Wars Episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back, 8M3 Lando's Palace. It's a really lovely little queue, and it basically is in two parts. It takes us through Cloud City, and then we go into Dagobah, and that's the last time we really sort of see Dagobah in the film, in this particular film anyway. And it's got lots of nice themes, the Luke Skywalker, the Force, Yoda's theme, and that sort of comes back again as well. And we've also got little hints of other things going on, so I'm just going to make a start. So although it's actually quite a long queue, the music is relatively straightforward in terms of the fact that it's not as complex as some other queues. So we make a nice start with a really sort of lovely, touching sort of moment at the beginning. Let's just play it. And then it leads into the film, so into the theme. I just love those two bars. You can hear the sort of rather eager clarinet who gets to the third beat a little bit too quickly at that point. I think I probably would have re-recorded that, really, but there we go. Maybe they ran out of time at that point. So we essentially have this sort of E pedal. It lasts. We got a little bit of filigree over the top, a sort of very small amount, really, with woodwind and doubled in the harp, which is lovely. And then we got a nice little sort of harp gliss as well, just on the same harp, actually. And then violin twos and violas just in thirds. And then the cellos and basses basically sort of combine like that, and sort of go outwards orchestrationally. It's a sort of E Phrygian, I think. So I've sort of identified some of the chords. You know, F with the major 7 doesn't have to have a fifth in it. But then we've got sort of E minor with a G. Then, but actually, that one is an F minor 7, really. Because I forgot the bass. There we go. And then we've got a sort of another sort of almost sort of a dominant type sort of thing. There's no third in it at this point. But it's a sort of minor dominant, which then goes to E major 7 at that point as well. A little bit of imitation on the flute after the clarinet. And then we're straight into the main Cloud City theme. So this is theme 15 in Frank Lehman, or FL for short. Sorry, Frank, I've abbreviated you. seems a bit inappropriate, but there we go. I'm sure you won't mind. So we're in E major at this point. We've got a nice sort of E pedal that goes pretty much all the way through. It does change a little bit right at the end as it goes to a semitonal shift. Remember that? That's sort of one of our sort of buzzwords that keeps cropping up. So it's literally doing that and then goes back down again, another semitonal shift, but more of an emphasis on sort of chords 1 and 4. Like that. And it's all about the major 7th. It's a very classic John Williams theme. So if we just listen to it, in fact, do I have the thing out? No. So I'm going to just try and find the file here. The orchestral one. That one. That's the one I wanted to have a look at. So it's all interlocked, of course, sort of horns 1, 2, 3, and 4, so they're all interlocked as they normally would be. Sort of clips, and then it actually continues in exactly the same vein as well. It's all in block chordal homophony. It's one of John Williams's favorite sort of horn styles, all close position. Notice the semitone at the top of the chord. That's a sort of not necessarily that unusual in Williams, but certainly it's the sort of thing that you might be frowned upon if you were doing a sort of jazz course, in an undergraduate sense, where you're just going to be very careful to have, be careful of the semitones between voices one and two, because it can just sound like a wrong note. But in this context, it's sort of very obvious what's going on. That's really that. All the chords are sort of written out, sort of E major 7, like that. I've sort of included the separate chord with the sharp 4, but I mean, you don't really need to. And then the standard inversion. So if you go into another harmony note, you just use the next available inversion to it, like that. That's a good example, that little arpeggiation there. So you will see that all of the inversions are the closest possible inversion that you can actually get to. And then we've got sort of quite an unusual trombone pedal at this point, which you sort of think, well, why didn't he use the bassoon at that point? But I think the reason being that A, he wanted a slightly different timbre, and possibly he wanted to keep it in the brass and not bother with any wind at that point. Just because it might stick out even more because of the fact it's not, although this is a rhythmic device on every crotchet beat, basically to percuss the dot. So you want dum, bum, 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 like that. So we can see those percussive dots in the dotted note in the time that it should happen, where the beat is, rather. So I think he did that for that reason, but I don't know. I mean, that's just a complete guess. And then we've got a winning combination of harp and glock, which are sort of playing in octaves at that point. In fact, no, they're not. They're playing, well, glock's two octaves higher. So, yeah, it's. I think they're sort of in octaves or double octaves, that sort of thing. And then we've got a really interesting sort of slightly militaristic viola accompaniment at that point as well. Which is quite hard to hear, actually, even on the album, but I'll just point out what it is doing. It's slightly imperial, isn't it? There's a sort of slight hint of it going on there, which I think is very clever, and that's definitely a conscious decision by Williams to sort of preempt what's about to happen. But to all intents and purposes, this is sort of rather happy, joyous sort of theme at this point. So as it continues, so we'll continue it. So I'll just do that because it just repeats basically. So rather strange. Actually, I'm just going to replay it because there's a little bit, I can almost hear a little oboe, but I think that is actually the trombone, but just the overtones. Yeah, it's just there. Yeah, bum, bum, bum. It's actually a muted trombone. It sounds like an oboe. It's really, really interesting. Very, very interesting. So then we got the second half of it, almost identical. Clarinets join. I'm just going to stop it there. So the second half of it is another sort of semitonal shift. So we've got the E major section at this point, all exactly the same, the only difference being at this point that we've got clarinets joining, and also there's a B minor 9 at this point because the chord has changed there, and then we also go all of that. So the A gives it that sort of ninth quality as well, like that. And then this little bit here just reminds me of the Shrovetide Fair from Petrushka. So it's all sort of pandiatonic in the sense that, you know, they're using all the available notes of, sort of F major, but without the B flat. So sort of F Lydian, I guess, at that point, because there are no B flats at that. I've just called it F, though, just because it just doesn't really sound that Lydian. I mean, I suppose it does. But the B sounds, it sounds though like it wants to resolve all the time. So that's why I've left it out. But it could be very well that it is actually Lydian. I've just been frightened to put it in case I'm wrong. But then, so this little bit, as I said, reminds me a little bit of the Shrovetide Fair. It's just... in the same sense that it's pandiatonic, there's just lots of sort of slushy notes just sort of going on, with, you know, mostly sort of triadic work at that point. In fact, here we've got four notes, so there's even more going on, but the upper extensions are all just dyadic, which is a sort of Stravinsky thing, which he also uses in Symphony of Psalms as well. If you have a look at the, I think it's the second movement particularly, that's the sort of texture that he tends to use. And then it's lightened up as well, because we've still got the glock, we've got that little sort of twinkle of the triangle, and pizzicato as well, with pizzicato strings going on as too. Notice that the tuba is not playing da da da, because it's more difficult to for the note to come out, so that's why there are only two quavers at that point. It's a sort of little orchestration tip for you. So then this carries on, and then it goes back to E on the chord change as well. So we've got this sort of little B flat major thing, which acts as a sort of dominant of F at that point. Where are we? Let's just put this back to that. I'm just using Film School Media's complete one. Let's just carry on a little bit. The writ. And now with the minims as well. With C3PO. Now, this is really clever. So this slight variation here, by the way, is simply varied because of these minim notes, which sort of carry on. They're all sort of part of the chord tones. There's nothing else unusual going on about them. And the sort of same chuggy effect sort of chugs on in the sort of basses and cellos. And then we've got this sort of little cheeky pizzicato, bum, 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 little sort of flat six at that point. With little sort of, you know, appoggiaturas, sort of, you know, chromatic inflected notes, I guess. And then we've got this solo horn. So it's all about the intervals here. And what's really interesting is that because it's C3PO, he gets, he's told to basically mind his own business by another protocol droid. So it's a derivation of the droid theme, but by interval inversion and reordering notes. So, for example, I put this in the same key. But so we have the same idea here. That's slightly different because it doesn't actually go up to any of those notes until... like that. So it's that's not written. That's just the droid theme that we're familiar with from earlier in the film. But you'll notice that those notes are very identical. They've just been reordered so that it starts on C instead of G sharp. It goes C, B, G sharp rather than G sharp, C, B. So it's a nice little sort of intervallic hint to it without being completely overt. And I love that Williams does that because it's a sort of it's the sort of clever compositional thing that you often get taught to do. In sort of composition lessons and things like that, sort of, you know, what can we get in there? You'll also notice that a lot of the accompaniment is derived from the melody itself. So we've got those notes here. And then we've got those notes as well. I think the E is missing, actually, but it's interestingly found in the original, so it sort of, like, replaces it. And we're into you know, like that. In fact, actually, this changes chord to that E major, and sort of oscillates between the two. So I won't sort of, you know, completely point it out, but essentially that's what it is, just this oscillation. And then we get into a very small hint of the Imperials theme. I'm just thinking of... It just reminds me a little bit of that. So I think, again, that's a purposeful hint from Williams. I've always wanted to know how he keeps track of these motives. Does somebody else help him? I don't know. It's not Frank, so I don't know who it is. Maybe maybe the music editor sort of points out, oh, that sounds a bit like this and blah. Or maybe he's just got such an extraordinary memory that he just knows. I would be very interested to find out. So anyway, so we're going from here. So that's quite a wild shift, isn't it? From E. Like that. So it's another sort of modulatory bit. And then it's that. And combined with the B flat, we've actually got little 3-3 or 0-8-11 in there, which is really wonderful. It's his sort of one way that he tends to sort of link from something very you know, key based diatonic into something less key based, or it's still key based but just a bit more dissonant, I think. So we got that real sort of hint of major and then minor and then that sort of E flat minor with the major seventh 4-19 chord. So that appears, and then with the A, it actually becomes a sort of 5-22, which is, you know, a sort of another one, basically. And it's very clearly Hungarian minor derived as well. So he always adds specific things that are generally going to make one of the usual scales, octatonic, hexatonic, Hungarian minor. And it seems apparent that the Hungarian minor is something that's used quite extensively in Empire Strikes Back, probably more so than we might have been led to believe formerly. So we've got these 4-19 chords. We've got an alpha chord coming up at this point as well. So it's an A-flat chord with a sharp 9 as well. So it's a sort of alpha chord like that, but actually we've actually got... So this is an unusual thing. Sometimes... I found this in a couple of pieces where the tuba is actually a third higher than the double bass. You get sort of really interesting, rich sonority with that. Don't forget that there's still quite a big gap between the next bass trombone, the third trombone, second trombone, and then smaller space as we go up. And then we've got this sort of slightly suggested suggested imperial rhythm as well. As 3PO gets completely clobbered at that point. So we've got the same sort of oscillations. This point is an A-flat sort of chord with a sharp 9, but basically it's a major-minor chord, alpha chord. Then we've got a minor chord with a major 7th, but with F in the bass, which is actually lower than that, would you believe? And then that oscillates. And then we got sort of slight added flutes, three of them, because there are four in this particular thing. You won't hear that on the live to picture version, of course, because they only book three. And then we shift into sort of A-flat unison. It's implied that it's A-flat minor. And then we've got that sort of wrong note bass. But actually, we've also got that major minor idea as well. So it's an interesting one. E minor above A flat. So that A flat becomes the G sharp of the next chord. So we got... Like that. It's very, very clever. Very, very subtle. It's the G natural quickly becomes G sharp. But because we've already got the A flat, that also becomes G sharp as well. So it's a... really interesting sort of little bit of modulation. So then we've got like that, this first inversion chord. Often first inversion chords can imply something is about to happen, You know, that sort of idea. And they're often used, you know, to introduce action as well in sort of opera or oratorio. You know, that sort of thing, to introduce something that's about to happen. So there's a long sort of history of first inversions sort of producing action, basically, or expectancy, I think is probably a better word for it. So that just goes down now to a D chord in first inversion. And you'll notice that, you know, often he puts the same notes in the accompaniment. So here, so they're all there, but with the D. So he gets this sort of slightly ambiguous chord, but it's basically just an add 9, add 13, because they're in the melody. So it's just a very good way of homogenizing it, basically. He does the same technique a little bit later on, we'll see. And then we've got Ambiguous Dyad. It sounds like a name of a prog rock band, doesn't it? Ambiguous Dyad. And then we've got this sort of little 3-8, but it's not that. It's not an Italian 6. It doesn't really have that function. But what happens is that we then have that F becomes a pivot note for the next key, which is actually Hungarian minor. Like that. So then we've got sort of Alien Gliss, we've got the electric piano, we've got Celeste as well going on, and we've got sort of tremolo strings as well. Notice that that's quite a common thing as well, where we only have dyads in the upper two voices. And you'll also notice, wanted to play the A. So they're just following the highlighting the little notes of the fourth theme at that point. Exactly the same here. In fact, they're sort of smudged together. And that's quite unusual, actually, that sort of... you know, just simply goes up into G minor at that point, which is interesting. So I'm just going to highlight these little things. Where are we? F minor. There we go. Yes. And then the G minor becomes the next sort of little enharmonic sort of, well, not harmonic shift, but it sort of basically just goes from F into G minor. So upper tone at that time. And then we've got the dark side of beware of the dark side of the force. And of course, you know, we've got that sort of Imperial March chords at that point. We've also got you know, that sort of thing, Hungarian minor, G minor at that point as well, I think you could argue. Hungarian question mark, let's do that. And then we've got a tertiary shift, so in other words, by roots descending or ascending a third, some form of third in this case. It's going up to a B flat. We've got this sort of, you know, Luke promises to return. It's not really derived from anything. It's a theme that we haven't really heard before, but it's a sort of treading water theme where there seems to be a bit of an avoidance of thirds. So it's 5th, 7th, 4th, 2nd, 6th. Okay, that's a 3rd, but there we go. And then it's more scalic. But there's very few... there's no sort of real arpeggiation. So there's lots of sort of, you know, oblique intervals. Sort of angularity. And it seems sort of quite ambiguous as well, sort of harmonically. Because we're... kind of been in G minor, but there's no G in the accompaniment at that point. And we got that sort of chord. So it's a B flat, add 9, add 11, I guess. You know, using that fourth in the bass, which he likes to do. That's a little bit strange, isn't it? I'll try and sort of shift that along. Let's try and do a bit of that. There we go. That just occurs. But you'll see again that a lot of the harmony is, you know, which came first? Was it the harmony that came first, or was it the melody that came first? Because they're very linked. You can see these notes which are in the melody, picking them out slightly. Like that sort of thing. So it's sort of almost suspended harmony over B flat, I think. And then we've got another tertiary shift to G Lydian at that point, and indeed, guess what? There's Yoda's theme. Like that, with lots of sort of twinkly little bits going on, so celeste and harp. And nice little sort of trombones and a big G pedal, which is, notice that the basses aren't doing tremolo, it's always the upper strings, or violas and violins rather. Or trills, I suppose, trill against the next note, that sort of thing. And again, just made up of those G Lydian notes. And that's where you have a slight change. Like that. So it's a sort of, is it G6 9/4? I think it's really a sort of A Lydian. Again, above G. So all sorts of different interpretations you could actually put over that. Like that. And then it actually ends up sort of interesting in here, in the trombones. Let's just have a listen to this. So it ends up sort of E minor chord at that point, but with everything else, it's still, you know, that sort of A chord, but above E as well. It's this really weird sort of shift in harmony with lots of these sort of coalescing notes. And it's difficult to argue, well, is it G bass or is it actually A based? It seems as though it should be G bass. But that everything is shifted up from G. So it's a sort of really weird, slightly ambiguous area at that point. Then we are in sort of on B, and then suddenly we're in Luke's theme. So happy Luke, but it doesn't sound particularly happy because it's just sort of, you know, I promise I'll be back sort of thing. And then a slightly ominous B, then a dyad, which is, again, derived from the actual melody itself. And then we've got a really interesting sort of Neo-Riemannian shift here. So if I hone in on this little thing, that becomes this, which is that sort of Bruckner-esque sort of move. So it's interesting, it's not even a whole sort of dyad. In fact, it's a sort of quartal chord, which becomes that. So everything's shifting by semitone, but in different ways. Some are going up, some are going down. So another typical sort of Williams-esque sort of ambiguity at that point. And then we've got another semitonal shift, which happens because of the F sharp to G. But we've also got a tertiary modulation, which goes from B to sort of G minor. And then we've got the fourth theme in G minor. So that occurs at that point. So I've also put G Hungarian minor because there's C sharp in there. So it's interesting, that semitonal slip is from 4M3, the asteroid field. But it seems to be a sort of thing that occurs in Empire at least more than once. In fact, I think it occurs three times, but I can't remember where the third one is. Somebody might be able to tell me. So we've got this little semitonal shift, or slip rather, amongst the fourth theme in G minor. That continues, and it's actually a more extended theme. You know, that full sort of arpeggio with a horn joining. And, you know, classic sort of harmony. And here it's slightly different. So it does do that sort of descending bass line. With suspensions, and then ends on G unison, and that's the end of the cue, and it almost immediately segues into the next one. So that is 8M3, or that was 8M3, Lando's Palace reduction. And really, I suppose the main sort of point really are these sort of lovely sort of major seventh chords right at the beginning, and the sort of interlocking horns, and the sort of hints of imperiality, which happens as well. So really, really fascinating. I'm going to try also, where are we? I think it is here. There we go. I've got Frank's catalogue up here as well. So I've been trying to sort of wade my way through. This is the updated one, which I'm not sure he's released yet, but it should be on its way. I was very, very happy to see that he's quoted me, which I think is really very, very kind. Thank you, Frank. That's very generous of you. So let's just take stock of where we are. So we're kind of coming towards the final third of the film now. So we've got Luke to the Rescue, which is the next one that turns up, another Al Woodbury cue. Vader shows up, then putting 3PO together, Trouble in Prison, Carbon Freeze, which with a couple of bars. Luke sees the Cactus, Chewie chokes Lando through the window, which I've just finished the orchestral score for. It's amazing. And losing a hand as well. And then to Hyperspace is the last sort of thing with the finale. Which is just wonderful. Really, really good, fantastic music. So we've had this sort of slightly sedate cue, and then it all gets a little bit more action orientated as well as we go along. So really looking forward to that, and I hope you've enjoyed today's fun. And we'll be back next time with, what was it, Luke to the Rescue. Absolutely. So let's hope he does quickly. Bye.